worship today. Amen. To bring a sacrifice of praise to the Lord. I was reminded this morning once again of a very short passage of scripture, Psalm 134. And verse 2 says, lift up your hands in the sanctuary and bless the Lord. Now we talk about lifting our hands in surrender. We talk about lifting our hands and you turn them this way when you're positioning yourself to receive. But I think we ought to pay special attention right now to just lifting our hands in the sanctuary to bless Him and to welcome His presence in this place. Would you just right now take some time? Let's just get our hands lifted up and our faces lifted up to the heavens right now. Hallelujah. Let's allow God to have His way. Lord, we worship You. We lift up our hands in this place to magnify Your name. Hallelujah, hallelujah. On this Palm Sunday, I want to be a part of that multitude that's dedicated to blessing You, Lord, to praising Your name, giving You what is due to Your name today. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Lord, You are worthy. Lord, You are worthy.
Sensitive to His spirit, that we would just move when He tells us to move.
Yes.
Subject, knowing what to say when you talk to yourself.
Yes.
Knowing what to say. Amen. If you say positive words, you'll have a positive attitude.
Yes.
If you have negative words,
you'll have a negative result.
That's right. I'm
kind of, in my spirit, I feel like David when he inquired of the Lord.
Hallelujah.
The enemy had taken all of his kids, his wives, all of his substance, and even those that were fighting with David. Some of his friends were fixing to stone him.
Yes.
And David was fearful. He wept. The Bible said he wept till he couldn't weep no more.
Amen.
There couldn't be no more weeping, but David inquired. He inquired.
Yes.
And the Lord God heard it. Amen. Let's inquire this morning of God. Whatever you have need of this morning, amen. God is able to do it right now. Father, we thank You for this day. We thank You for Your presence. We thank You for Your peace that passes all understanding. We pray, Lord, that You would have Your way in this service. Touch the music, the musicians, the singers. Let us give our hearts to You fully. Jesus' mighty name. Do a work, I pray, Lord. In Jesus' name.
Psalm 119:24 says, this is the day which the Lord has made.
runs with love for me, and I will open up my heart. Let the healer set me free. I'm happy to be in the truth, and I will daily lift my hands, for I will always see you when you're looking down. I can sing of your love forever. 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 Oh,
now it's time to take our needs before the Lord, and I believe that He is in this place and He is here for each and every one of us to call out on His name for whatever needs that we might have today. I know today that we need to remember Sister Beth Wheatley. She has a migraine, and we know that God is going to touch her even in this time right now, that He is going to heal her from her migraine. We also need to remember Youth Convention is right around the corner. We need to pray for our youth that they would be able to receive what God would have for them at Youth Convention this year. I know it's probably going to be great, and there's going to be a lot of opportunity for them to be blessed by the Lord, and we just need to lift them up in our prayers today. And also pray for them to have a safe trip there and back. Also, as always, we need to remember our community, that they would continuously receive revelation of truth. And as I always say as well, we need to remember each other, pray for each other, lift each other up, that we would always be sensitive to God's direction, where He would want to take us, who He would want to take us to, and have us to minister into their lives in this community. Because believe it or not, we are the key to the door.
Yes, yes, amen.
That God has to open for somebody in this community. Let's go to Him in prayer right now for all these needs. If you have a need today that wasn't mentioned, just lift up your hand right where you're at, and God is going to come by and He's going to touch your life today. Lord, we thank You for this day. We thank You, God, for the opportunity to come into Your house and to give You praise and to worship You and to just be here in this place together. God, we pray right now that You would touch Sister Beth today. You know, God, You see her migraine, God. You know what she's dealing with. God, we pray that You would just touch her body and heal it and make it whole in the name of Jesus. I pray right now for the kids that are going to go to Youth Convention this week, God. I pray right now that You would open up their minds and their hearts to receive the word that You would have for them in each service. God, that they would come back changed, that they would, something would just be different in their life when they come back. In the name of Jesus, God, I pray that You would keep Your hand of protection upon them as they go and when they come home. Lord, just keep Your hand over them and protect them, God. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Right now, God, I pray for this community. I pray that Your Spirit would flow out of each one of us everywhere we go, every step that we take, God. That You would just help us, God, to be in tune with You, God. That You would show us the person that needs to hear about You today. That You would help us, God, to spread Your gospel in this community, Lord. In the name of Jesus, God, I pray for every person that's in this room right now, whatever their needs might be, God, that You would just move by them where they're at right now, that You would touch their mind, that You would touch their body, God, that You would give them Your Spirit today. God, I pray that You would help somebody to just repent today and take that first step toward You in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah, God. I pray more than anything right now that Your Spirit would saturate this room, God, and that every person would be blessed by it, and every person can feel it, God, and they cannot leave here and say that they didn't feel it today, God. In Jesus' name.
Thank you.
now.
Oh, I love you, God.
Thank you, Jesus.
You are worthy, Jesus.
You're worthy of the praise, oh God. There is none like you, Jesus. None that compares to you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, praise team, for leading us in worship. Hallelujah. Welcome.
You, God. We love you, God.
We welcome our guests today.
Thank you,
the house of the Lord.
Thank you, God.
We're glad that God is here. He would be in this place with us.
Thank you, God.
There's no place like the presence of God. He's moving. He's working. Touching our hearts, our lives. It's just a wonderful experience. If you have your Bibles, if you would be turning with me to the book of John, St. John, the Gospel according to John, however it's worded, chapter number 13. I'm going to read a few verses. While you're doing that, let me just encourage you to invite somebody to church with you next Sunday for Easter. You know, they might not come just any old time, but a lot of people will come to church on Easter. They want to make that a part of their year. And so this is an opportunity that you have to bring somebody with you to the house of God. Just remember to do that. I encourage you to do that. In addition to that, this is Building Fund Sunday. It's our Sunday, and we are going to be starting very soon. So if you'd like to give to that, you give on this day, the day it's designated, then I encourage you to do so. If you give another time, that's okay too. Whatever you want to do. And just so you're mentally prepared, we will be soon taking up our Save Our Children's offering. And we haven't mentioned this yet. I believe next Sunday is actually the official date, but that's okay. But we will be taking up a special offering for the Save Our Children, which is the national offering, and it funds so many wonderful things. Children's Crusades and Junior Camp and just Bible quizzing and different ministries. And so, just so you're aware of that, so you're not thrown off when we really get into talking about it, so that way you know it feels good in the house of the Lord. The book of John, chapter number 13. We're going to begin with verse number 1. We're going to read down to verse number 10. And I don't want you to get nervous when you hear the text, but some of you might. It says, "Now before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour was come, that he should depart out of this world unto the Father, having loved his own which were in the world, he loved them until the end. And supper being ended, the devil having now put into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he was come from God and went to God, he riseth from supper, and he laid aside his garments, and he took a towel, and he girded himself. After that, he poureth water into a basin, and began to wash the disciples' feet, and to wipe them with the towel wherewith he was girded. And then it came to Simon Peter, and Peter saith unto him, Lord, dost thou wash my feet? And Jesus answered and said unto him, What I do thou knowest not now, but thou shalt know hereafter. And Peter said to him, he said, You shall never wash my feet. And Jesus answered him, If I wash thee not, thou hast no part with me. And so Simon Peter changed his tune, and he said, Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head. And Jesus said to him, He that is washed needeth not to save to wash his feet, but he is clean every whit. And you are clean, but not all. You put your Bibles down, and if you would go with me into a time of prayer. I feel God's given me a very encouraging word, but a good word for us today. Can we go to him in prayer right now that he would speak to our hearts? Lord, we love you. God, I'm so thankful for your presence that we can enter into this place and we can come here, God, and we can lift up your holy name and we can sing beautiful songs that lift you up, God, but that we don't just sing songs that bounce off the walls, but you are here and we're able to worship you, God. So, God, I pray as we move forward that you would begin to speak to our hearts and that you would minister to us. God, those things that we're in need of, that you would just begin to fill up inside of us, those voids, those hurts, God, those moments of insignificance, God, that you would help us realize that the God of the universe loves us, cares for us, and is there for us. In Jesus' name, speak to us, God. Speak to us, God, in Jesus' name. Man, you can be seated. We find here at the beginning that they are together. Jesus and his disciples are together. And they're meeting before the feast of the Passover. And Passover officially began yesterday. And come Friday, as I was kind of going through everything, and I was just going through my nightly routines, and then I thought, I'm preaching Sunday. I don't have anything yet to preach, and normally by this point, God's already spoken something to me, at least began to lay the foundation for something. And it was just within a few moments' notice of having that thought that God began to speak to me.
Yes.
And I knew instantly that I was in the presence of the Lord, and I began to just reflect over the Passover and the beauty therein of something that was so dark in the world that night. And just so that way we get into it and people really understand what's going on, the Feast of the Passover is a Jewish feast that celebrates when Jesus passed over. You see, we go way back thousands of years, and we find that the Israelites, the children of God, they are in Egypt, and they're not in Egypt under good times. It's not the same as it was when Joseph was there. The memory of Joseph is long gone. There is no favor for the Israelites. There's nothing pleasant for them. And so they're in a dark place. They are literally the slave labor that is building the nation, conquering surrounding areas. And so we get to Moses, and Moses was raised there and fled, and God speaks to him and sends him back. And they go through all of these different plagues. You know, you got locusts. I don't want locusts. We had flies outside last week. I didn't like flies. I wouldn't want locusts. They had frogs, the water turned to blood, and it worked for a moment, but before they could leave, Pharaoh said no, and so finally the death angel comes. The death angel is going to take the firstborn in every household unless the blood is covering the doorpost. And so what they did is they had this celebration, they had this night, and they would offer up the sacrifice, and they put the blood over the post of the door, and everybody that was inside of the house where the blood was at was covered. And if the person couldn't afford, they could go to their neighbor's house, and they were still covered. And it was a beautiful thing because the death angel passed over those houses, and because of the faithfulness of God, it became such a meaningful point that it became a feast in the Israel culture, in the Jewish culture. And so that's where we find things. They are gathered together like they would every year for the Feast of Passover. And the disciples don't realize that there's really anything different about this year than probably there was the previous year. We're just gathered together getting ready for Passover. But there are things that are working that they don't realize. There are things that are taking place that they are not yet aware of. And so we find here in our scripture where at some point, either it's just prior to dinner or maybe it's in the middle of dinner. We're not really sure based on what John gives us in this account. But what we do know is that there are some things that are happening. There are some movings that are taking place. It says the devil has put into the heart Judas Iscariot that he's going to betray Jesus. And Jesus knows all of these things, and he knows that this is what is right. And so he rises up from supper. He said, maybe they're done, maybe they're not. They go back to the table afterwards. I don't know. Maybe they eat two meals. I wouldn't mind that sometimes. Depends on what they're eating. And so he rises from supper and he casts off his garments, takes off the old jacket that maybe he was wearing. Scripture says it's a little cool during that time there. And so he takes off his jacket perhaps and he casts it to the side. And the disciples, they're probably watching thinking, well, Jesus is getting comfortable. This is going to be a good night. Says that he takes out a towel. He takes that old towel and he wraps it around himself. And they're looking and they're saying, now this isn't right because this isn't what Jesus should be doing. He goes and he gets a basin and he gets a pitcher and he goes and he starts. And instantly now they know what's taking place. But this isn't right because the master doesn't wash the servant's feet. He doesn't decide that he is going to lower himself. And so we read this, and I've heard this so many times in my life, how Jesus set an example in humility and lowered himself to wash the feet. And we do this around here sometimes just in special services. We'll have a foot washing service. And some people say, I don't want to come to the foot washing service. And so, you know, one year we might do foot washing and communion. One year we might just do communion. And people, well, is this foot washing and communion or is this just communion? We laugh, but we know it's true because it's not something that we like in our flesh. It's not something we like in our inside of us that just says, yeah, let me get down and wash somebody's dirty feet. It's not our culture. It was their culture that somebody would do this. They wore those sandals and or they might have closed shoes, but it's dirt roads and their feet are dirty. Yeah. You see, when you're going down the journey, your feet get dirty. And apparently we're at this place where Jesus, he's decided, I got to do something right now. They're not going to have me much longer here, so let me do something. Let me prepare the way right now. But as I began to read this Friday night, as I began to read this and reread it in my mind all day yesterday, I realized there's something so much deeper that is transpiring here than just an example of what needs to be done. This is not just an example of humility where Jesus said, you can't become the servant even if you're of an elevated status. It goes so much deeper than that. And so I'm not here to talk about the humility side of what took place. It's a good message, but it's for another day. Mm-hmm. But it says that he wrapped that towel around him and he got some water. And he poured water out of a pitcher into a basin. And it says that he began to wash the disciples' feet. Now, I don't know the order that he went in. I don't know how he started it. I just know that he started to wash feet. Yes. Maybe he started with John because he was the beloved and that was just expected. I don't know. But I do read that he is washing the disciples' feet. Yes. And regardless of where Peter's at. I know he's not at the beginning, but he comes to Simon Peter, and Peter says, Lord, what do you think you're doing right now?
Yeah.
Do you think that you're going to wash my feet? Now, Peter, he's kind of a loose cannon. You might not realize it here, but Jesus, they're on a boat. Jesus says, what do y'all want to come join me? And Peter, just without thinking, he's just off the boat.
Yeah.
Right.
It's not a bad thing per se, but he is just in that moment. That's where he's at. And as you go forward a little bit, and when you get more into what took place just after this, you realize Peter was definitely a loose cannon. And so what he said, Jesus, what are you doing? You're not washing my feet. You're my Lord. You're my master. I serve you. You don't serve me. But listen to what is taking place here. Because Jesus answers and said unto him, what I'm doing right now, you don't understand. But you're going to know in a little while. Mm-hmm. You're going to realize it at some point. We know that throughout this night there is conversations about the kingdom of God and who's going to have these high positions. Who's going to serve where in your kingdom? And in their mind and in Peter's mind, this is a literal kingdom. He believes that Jesus is about to start an uprising on earth in that moment. And he is positioning. He's jockeying for a position in that moment. Uh-huh. He says, you're Lord and Master, and I serve you. Jesus, he says, you don't know what's about to happen. You don't understand, because Jesus already knew. Peter, you are thinking about this earth, but I am thinking beyond this earth. So Peter says, even after hearing that, Jesus says, you don't know what I'm doing. Peter says, you'll never wash my feet. I can't let you do it. I can't let you do that right now, because that is not the proper etiquette in this place. Again, it was Jewish custom. It was just what they did back then. Dirty robes. A servant would wash somebody's feet, or at least present water so that feet could be washed. And here we have Jesus and the disciples are equal, and Jesus is elevated. Jesus comes and says, I got to wash your feet too, Peter. And Peter says, no, Lord, not mine. Jesus answers him in a peculiar way, given all things. And I believe this is the reason that when I read this, I understand that there is so much more depth to what is taking place. Because Jesus answered him and said, if I wash thee not, you have no part with me. That wasn't about humility. Jesus didn't need humility. He was humbled when he became flesh. It wasn't about humility in this moment. When he continues and he says, now you go do it, that was about humility, but this wasn't about humility. He says, I got to wash your feet, Peter. And Simon Peter, he says unto him, Lord, if you really got to do it, not just my feet, but I need you to wash my hands and I need you to wash my head. Jesus says to him, Peter, already had a bath. Peter, you're already cleansed. He says, he that is washed needeth not but to wash his feet, but he's clean everywhere else. He says, Peter, you're clean. Everybody here is not clean, but Peter, you're clean. I'm not going to wash your hands, I'm not going to wash your head, but let me wash your feet. I began to think about this, and I began to spend time with God, and God just began to speak to me in this moment. Because here's Jesus, and he's over here, and he's bent down, and Peter is sitting in a chair, and he's saying, no, don't do it. And Jesus Jesus says, you've got to let me do this. You've got to let me do this, Peter, because there's a journey that you've been on, and there's a journey that you're going on, and your feet are dirty.
Yes.
Right.
Amen.
He says, but Peter, you're clean. You are clean, but your feet are dirty because of the journey.
Right.
He says this. I felt I had a revelation in my spirit when I was with God. Because we must understand that Jesus is God in the flesh. He knows everything. He knows the beginning all the way through the end. He knows how all of it has played out and will play out. And he knows Peter. He knows Peter is a kingdom man. He doesn't question whether or not Peter loves him, but he's aware of the journey.
Man.
He's aware of who he is as a person. And so he says, Peter, it's not that you're dirty that you need to be cleansed again. He says, the journey has your feet dirty. Not your hands, not your head. Peter, but life just happens sometimes and your feet are dirty. Let me just wash them while I can. We can continue. We can really put focus on what Jesus did that night. Because Jesus washed the feet of the disciples. All of them. I notice there's a quote. It says that Judas 8:2, maybe you've heard that. People, they read that and it elicits emotions that Jesus knew that Judas was going to betray him following that meal, but he still allowed him to eat. I got to take it another step deeper. Jesus cleansed his feet for the journey. He said, Judas, I know where you're going to go because Satan's already in your heart. You're not clean, but I'm just going to go ahead and clean your feet and say the journey's okay because it's part of God's will. So here's Peter. He's also getting his feet clean. He says, no, this isn't right, but I'm going to let you. I'm going to let you now because I recognize this is important to you. I'm going to get my feet clean, but I still don't understand why you're doing it. They go through the night. And Jesus says something to Peter. He says, Peter, you do know you're going to betray me 3 times in just a short amount of time. I want you to know something, Peter. You can still get your feet cleaned because you're not dirty. The journey just led you through a dirty place. The journey just took you through a spot that was a little muddier than what you anticipated. Peter said, not me, Lord. Everybody else might. I won't betray you. I'm not going to deny you. I'm not going to do that. I'm a kingdom man, Jesus. Jesus said, all right. Think what you will. Judas leaves. What's he do? He goes out. He sells out Jesus for just a few measly pieces of silver. And they take Jesus away. And Peter is distraught because this is a part of the kingdom. He thinks the kingdom's supposed to be taking place. The uprising's about to happen. There goes Jesus. He's hauled off, and they're going to execute him by crucifixion. And there's the servant of the high priest, and she says, hey, that's one of them. That's one of them. That was one that was with Jesus. And he says, no, not me. You don't know me. You don't know who I am. And she says, yes, I do. You're from Galilee. You're one of them. I know you are. Says, not me. I don't know what you're talking about. I don't understand what you're talking about. It's not me. She goes and tells people that's him. And the Bible says that he began to curse. And he said, I'm not him. Instantly, that old rooster began to crow a second time. And Peter knew what he had done. That he had denied Christ three times, just as he had predicted. Peter, what you don't understand is you betrayed him. You denied him in that moment. Realize God's already called you clean, and he's just saying your feet are dirty. Well, I'm not going to discard all of you just because your feet are dirty. But I'm preparing you for something. Wash your feet. And I believe that if there was the opportunity in that moment, even afterwards, that Jesus would have came back to Peter and said, I see that you did what I said you were going to do, but let me just wash your feet here. Let me just cleanse those feet one more time, because the journey is dirty.
Yes.
I'm here to cleanse you. I'm here to cleanse you. You're not dirty, but your feet are dirty. Why does it matter? Why is it so important? Jesus said, my feet are clean. Scripture says in Exodus, God gave the command to Moses that the building of the tabernacle and the placement. And the Lord says in Exodus chapter number 30 and verse number 17, the Lord spoke unto Moses, saying, thou shalt also make a laver of brass, and his foot also of brass to wash withal, and thou shalt put it between the tabernacle of the congregation and the altar. And there you should put water in. For Aaron and his sons shall wash their hands and their feet also, so that when they go into the tabernacle of the congregation, they shall wash with water that they die not. Or when they come near to the altar to minister, to burn offering made by fire unto the Lord, so they shall wash their hands and their feet that they die not. And it shall be a statute forever to them, even to him and to his seed throughout their generations, that before you go to the altar, you wash. What Peter didn't realize is that Jesus was about to tear the veil that separated man from the altar. And Jesus was saying to Peter, let me prepare you for this journey. Let me wash your feet. Let me wash your feet. Because I want to get you ready. Ready for the journey to a place filled with redemption. I feel that God wants to tell somebody, you are not dirty. You just need your feet cleaned. I don't know where this journey has taken you in life. I don't know where you've gone, but just realize you just need
place in order to get to an altar of repentance. You just need to get yourself to that place. Jesus says, I'll help you get there. I'll help you get to that altar. I will lower myself. I'll bend down. I'll wash those feet so that you can make it and not perish. The journey is dusty and the road is dirty. You can be clean. You can be clean. Don't let your conscience tell you you can't do it. Don't let your brain try to interfere in what God wants to do in your life. It doesn't matter what journey you have been on, right, or how dirty your feet might look. You can clean them because Jesus is there with his towel on, ready to cleanse you. Next step, the next place. Somewhere along the line, it finally struck with Peter what was taking place and what was happening. It's probably after the resurrection of Jesus that he finally realized what this night actually meant and how it transpired and what Jesus was really doing in that moment. I don't think Peter questioned after he finally had that revelation whether or not he was clean. Now, I believe wholeheartedly that he still had to find a place of repentance along the journey because he's flesh, and all that our flesh do fail God.
Yes.
But I think he finally had an understanding that I can just go and wash my feet. I don't have to throw myself away. I don't have to quit. I don't got to leave.
Right.
I just got to wash my feet. Yeah. Because Jesus said I was still clean. It was just the journey that made me a little dirty. And I'm here to tell you, it's just the journey that's maybe made you a little dirty. But Jesus will wash your feet.
Yeah.
He will cleanse you.
Hallelujah.
He will forgive you.
Thank you.
He will cover you with his blood.
Yes, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God.
And so, I began to think of the words of Paul when he was writing to the Romans. And he said, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things. And I just believe within my spirit today that that was not in reference to somebody having been born with some naturally beautiful feet. But I believe it had to do with the fact that Jesus cleanses their feet.
Man.
He covers them. He takes that old basin of water and he puts their feet in it, and he begins to pour and he begins to rub and he begins to dry, because journey got their feet dirty, but they're still beautiful in the sight of God.
Amen.
They're still beautiful in the sight of God. So today, I don't know how you walked into this place. Maybe your feet were clean when you walked in, or maybe there's so much junk caked on you don't think you can get clean. But Jesus is here, and he wants to cleanse you.
Amen.
You can leave this place, and you can declare these words, that beautiful are your feet, because you know this gospel, and it is inside of you. It's inside of you. I'm quickly coming to a close. If you would stand with me. Jesus knew every step that Peter would take. Peter didn't even realize he needed them to be cleaned. But Jesus foresaw what was going to take place. He says, Peter, you're not dirty. Peter, you're still my disciple. Peter, I still love you. Peter, you're still faithful.
Hallelujah.
Peter, I'm not replacing you. I'm not casting you aside. Right. You're still valuable.
Yeah. Right. Amen. That's good.
Peter, it's not that you're dirty, but the journey has gotten your feet just a little dusty.
Yes.
Peter, let me wash them. Peter, let me cleanse you because I'm about to open up that altar and you need to be able to get there freely. I'm about to rip that veil. You can go all the way in to the Holy of Holies if you want to, but you've got to have your feet clean.
Yes, amen. Praise God. Praise God.
And so Peter, realize this. Jesus isn't talking about your actual feet. He's in the spirit with you right now, and he wants to cleanse you for this journey.
Oh, yes. Thank you, God.
So,
thank you, God.
Peter, if you let me do this, then you will have part of me. But if you don't, because the only thing that can separate us from the love of God is our own sin.
Right.
And an unrepentant heart. But Jesus is here today with that basin of water, and his towel is girded around him, and he's saying, I'm here to wash the feet of whoever needs it.
Yes.
I'm here to cleanse you for this journey. So it doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter if you are the beloved John, the spitfire Peter, or the about to betray Judas. Jesus is here for everyone.
Yes.
To wash their feet. I want to open this altar today, and I believe that we just need to come to a place where we can just say, Lord, here am I. This journey gets me dirty sometimes. Life has me down sometimes. I've made mistakes. I've messed up. I've not always been what you wanted me to be, but God, here I am.
Yes, Lord.
Would you cleanse my feet?
Yes, Lord.
Would you wash me for the journey? Not just the journey I've been on, but the journey you're going to take me on. Prepare me. Prepare me for where I'm going. Prepare me for where I'm going. Oh, in Jesus' name. Let's find a place to pray today. You can pray at your seat. You can pray at this altar. It doesn't matter. You can stand. You can kneel. You can sit. Jesus is here, and he's saying, I'll take care of it. This journey that you've been on, I already know about it. You don't have to be ashamed of it. I knew how you were walking. I knew what you were walking through. I'm just here to clean your feet. I'm just here to cleanse you. I'm just here to make things new. I'm here so you can declare beautiful. Beautiful. Beautiful are the feet. Those who carry the gospel.